This is the Real Estate Marketing Podcast, where we teach you how to grow your real estate business. Whether you're a wholesaler, investor, or realtor, this podcast is for you. Hey, and welcome back to the Real Estate Marketing Podcast. I'm Austin Glanzer.
And I'm Adam Grimm.
And today we are bringing on Matt Teifke. He has been doing a ton of stuff in real estate in Austin, Texas, where he has a brokerage, he has a property management company, and he's done all of it in his 20s, which is even cooler. So I'm really excited to have him share his story, give some advice to you guys, especially to the younger listeners out there who are trying to get started in real estate, just to hear him share his experience, how he's grown, and he's just a really cool guy. So I'm excited for him to talk. But before we jump into that, Adam, you've been out of town for a little while doing a bunch of different things, and I thought maybe the listeners should get an update on your life.
Yeah, so we've been traveling. We were in Columbus, Ohio for most of July visiting some family out there. But the big news is, if you've listened to the podcast before, we've talked, I'm an owner of Sparrow Websites, or was an owner of Sparrow Websites, a website design development firm, and I sold my web design development agency, actually. So that's the biggest news from July, and now we're pivoting a bit, and going to practice what we preach and get into some more real estate investing and also do some marketing consulting on the side.
Yeah, awesome. And could you talk a little bit just about maybe the process of selling your business? I know a lot of people listen, they're like, yeah, I want to sell my business. Like, was it easy? Was it hard? How did that go?
Yeah, it was surprisingly easy. It was a little bit easier because I had had business partners and I was able to sell to one of my partners. He purchased the whole agency. The first tricky part was just getting a good valuation of the business. But in the agency space, there's some pretty standard calculations and things like that. So we went to our accounting firm and they drew up some numbers for us. And we didn't get an official appraisal done, but we kind of came to a number that we were all happy with. So I think that was a little easier. In most cases, if you're selling to a third party, you'd have to get an official appraisal. But from there, the financing part was easy. The bank was able to finance a lot of the sale for my business partner. And because, the business value is kind of based on hard numbers, that was pretty straightforward. So honestly, the whole process took about a month and a half for when we started talking to lawyers and banks and finished everything. So from what I understand, it's pretty quick. It's actually been a pretty painless process. And I'm excited to see what comes next.
Yeah, that's awesome. Super excited for you in this next journey. And you're trying to get into real estate a little bit more too, huh?
Yeah, with Austin as my guide. So again, for those of you listening, I'm usually the marketing guy on this podcast and Austin gives us the real estate insights. So I'm going to leverage that a bit. So looking to buy a rental property here locally with some sage advice from Austin.
Well, I don't know if my advice is the best, but we're going to try to get you a podcast document, not a podcast, a rental property, document that. But anyways, yeah. That'd be good for some listeners to hear about the exciting news in your world. But anyways, Matt, you are here. You've been sitting a little quietly waiting for us to get to you. So would you mind just saying hi to the audience here?
Yeah, absolutely. And congrats on the deal. I know that's a big deal. I've been through some similar things, and I know that there's probably a ton of work that went into that. So you deserve that. Congrats. And I'm excited to be here. I'm happy to jump in, dive in, add value, help wherever I can. I enjoy doing podcasts and just want to be a resource to the best of my ability for the people that are listening and try to give them real action items or real value and, not just any fluff, but like really get to it. And I'm happy to help any way I can.
Yeah. So if you wouldn't mind just telling us about everything you're doing, because I know you have a podcast, you have a company, brokerage, management company, like tell us about like everything that you're currently doing.
Absolutely. So it's been about 10 years in the works. I started when I was 17. And at this point, we are pretty early on getting a lot of the things that I've been dreaming of up and running. And so for the first 10 years, I spent just learning the business, making money on real estate brokerages or on real estate brokerage commissions, on personal flips, on personal buy and holds, a little bit of lending, like private money. And just focused on, making money and setting myself up to be able to have an infrastructure to really grow a really big business. That's the dream. And so we started with property management as far as our business. And then what we did was we got up to about 250 single family homes that we were managing. We had brought on 10 or 15 real estate agents. And then what we did was we merged our management company with another company here in Austin. So my wife and I own 30% of the new company. And right now we've got about 750 single family homes, and we're actively trying to grow and bring the right people on. So that's one aspect of it. And then I have a real estate brokerage that I own 50-50 with another partner here in town. And what we're trying to do, so we have about 35 agents right now, and we're trying to create our own ecosystem in a sense. And really the goal is for now to become the Austin real estate resource. Like when you think of Austin real estate, hopefully you think of TRE or Typekey Real Estate, and you know that, like, you know what, who we are and what our mindset is as far as just really putting everything out there and adding value, a huge like Gary Vee type mentality. And so what we're doing is we're building out branches of our company to be able to have this ecosystem where everything can value and benefit each other. So we have we have TRE Construction, we have TRE Wholesaling, TRE Capital, TRE Leasing, and then the Real Estate Brokerage. And of these branches, and it sounds crazy, but there's been a lot of work and time and effort put into getting these things set up. And they're very good and experienced partners that are running these branches. So my 50-50 partner on the brokerage and I will own a minority share of all of these branches. Some of them, it might be 50-50, depending on what the roles are and what we do. But the kind of general concept is we would own 25%, 30% of each branch. And then where we would help is on the marketing, on the lead generation, and then on the bookkeeping. And then if it turns into we're doing more than that, then maybe it would be 50-50. But I'll give you an example. Our construction branch, the partner was a police officer for 29 years, and then he had his own construction business for 11 years. And he has probably got, you know, last year they did $1 million in revenue. He has like 10 or 11 jobs. So it's an established business that's working, and he knows what he's doing. And then they saw value in us on the marketing, on the growth, and just liked who we were. So that's a huge thing that we'll probably get into, but I'm just such a big, big believer in the right people and just thinking long term and everyone growing together, not having to own 100% of everything. So we're trying to get the construction branch. I mean, all four of these new branches are relatively new for us. But all the people that are running them have already been doing this for a while. So we're very lucky to have it and blessed to have this situation. And then we'll just come in and handle the marketing, like I said, all the other stuff. And I guess to back up a little bit, about 4 years ago when we started the management company, we made a huge bet on the social media aspect of everything. So one of my really good friends does all of our social media. We've got a YouTube channel, a podcast, on every platform. We're posting constantly. You actually talked me into getting him on TikTok. Now we've got like 7 videos on TikTok, and I wish we would have done that earlier. But we paid him a full-time salary as a management company to go out and build this brand and do something a little different and put our spin on it. And it's, you know, now finally coming to a point where people are noticing it a little bit more, and it's starting to generate a little bit more. So that was a huge aspect of our company. It was me going out and being an operator and doing the work. And, you know, we can get into as much as you want, but basically for 10 years, I mean, no doubt, like just doing almost everything I possibly could, like 24/7, never missed a phone call, never missed a text, never missed an email, grinding really, really hardcore and like being an operator. And now I'm kind of stepping back and trying to put the right people in place. And then, you know, still to this day, I'm like, all right, what do I do next after I get this set up? Do I go and start cold calling again and tracking down owners, or do I keep networking and bringing in the leads? But the marketing has been a huge component of our business. And it's a big reason why these new partners are, you know, signing up with us. You know, people feel like they already know us in a lot of ways. I mean, we're putting out at this point a new video every single day, and it's been a long time in the works, and it's a big investment. I mean, we've essentially, you know, probably paid over $200,000-$300,000 in the salary when it's hard to measure the results that have come, like, it's not easy to measure, at least as far as I know, like how building this brand has benefited us. Cause it's not like, hey, you know, here's the amount of leads, here's what we're spending, here's what it's worth. It's just different. It's hard to measure. Now we've got a new construction partnership because they see a ton of value in that. And what is that worth? So we've just, we don't even really try, maybe to a fault, but we just believe in it and we're committed to that. And we just keep going, man. It's funny because we're still feel like we're early as far as where we want to go. I mean, we're very ambitious. And back to the people, it's like we just get as many people around as we can and add as much value. Like, I'm so big onto that. I'll have people say, like, here's how you can help me. And I'll go spend 24 hours trying to make that happen. And thinking with a 20, 30 year mindset with everything that I do. And I think a lot of people miss that. They don't understand, like, when you're cold calling, you know, you're going to cold call someone and very, very rarely are they going to say, yeah, we got a deal, I'll sell. It's like, no, that's going to happen on the sixth month after the eighth phone call. But everyone does that first phone call and they move on and they think that's a dead lead. So it's just, you know, that's kind of a broad overview, but then just the certain things that we're constantly trying to do is the mindset and bring the people around. And we're doing a Google Hangout call 4 times a week. It's free. And we're like, hey, just come join the team, be around it. And some of these people are going out and wholesaling, not through our company, and we're teaching them and they're making a lot of money. And we're not seeing any of that, but we're so committed to adding the value and having the right people around us. And we're just trying to figure it out. But hopefully that makes sense. Just a quick overview of what we got going on.
Yeah, that's awesome. Everything that you're doing. And it's honest. It's actually an inspiration to me. Even since we talked on the phone, what was it, 2 or 3 weeks ago, I've been thinking about ways that I could partner with people in my area to flip houses, do the contracting. It was kind of a new way for me to think about doing my business. So even just listening to you share that, it's an inspiration to me to kind of follow what you're doing. So that's awesome. I do want to just jump back for a second here. You said you started when you were 17. So can you talk a little bit about like that beginning steps of getting into real estate, deciding to do it? I mean, that's pretty young to get started.
Yeah, man, I feel very blessed that I picked it early, and it actually really came from my mom. She was a single mom. She was literally cleaning houses, and then my uncle started an asphalt construction paving business. My mom started working there, and what she did was she would buy one or two houses every year, and she did that for 10 or 15 years, and I saw her make a ton of sacrifices. I saw what it took, and then my eyes were open to real estate and how that can be generational wealth. And, you know, she always was like, hey, these are something that I want to pass down to you and your brother. And it got me thinking like, man, she's done something so amazing. If I could go work twice as hard because I'm doing it full time, then I could go grow this. And it's funny because it never turned into that. And I'm not counting on that by any means, but my thought was always, let me go, you know, look at my mom's properties, help her buy and sell new ones and constantly trade up. But we've just kind of left those alone. And I just started making money on my own on the brokerage and learning things and getting into this world. But I started, you know, in college, and I mean, I can't stress this enough. It's just so intensely focused on this. For 10 years, like really, I mean, I used to Google 6 times a day the word real estate and just see what article pops up and try and learn. And I would find people that would sit down with me for an hour a day and teach me. And so I started working at a local real estate brokerage in Corpus Christi where I was going to school. And I'd sit down with a mentor. I would wear a suit and tie every day. I was the first one in, the last one out. I was still going to school. I hated going to school. And I just like couldn't wait to get out and go, you know, drum up some leads. I put stickers on my car. It was my school was Texas A&M Corpus Christi. So I put, it was a TAMUCC realtor. We'll help you find a lease property. It's completely free. Seller pays my commission. Created a Twitter, a YouTube, and just started like branding myself that way. And I was just obsessed with it. And I learned like, the only way to do this successfully is like, you got to be on it. And I made a lot of sacrifices, and I've learned that over time, like that's critical. I mean, my friends would be going out to the beach, and I'd be going too, and I'd get a call to show a house like, hey, sorry guys, I got to go. And you could pass up on that lead, or you could try and go take it down. And then that lead will lead to five other leads. And so it was just never missing anything that I could do. I was jumping on it and doing the best that I could and trying to think long term. So, you know, I did that all through college. And then whenever I graduated, I came back home and I started working at a commercial real estate brokerage. And then what I wanted to do, because I learned about this real estate program at Texas A&M and College Station, and it's a master's degree of real estate. And so I went there, and that was a big game changer for me, because that was 100% commercial focused. And I had a lot of experience. So I had 2 or 3 years of experience. Like my first year, I made like 7,000. My second year, I made 15. My third year, I made 45. And I was a senior in college. And I'm like, man, next year I'll make 65. Like, this is pretty good. But I wanted to do more than that. I saw a little bit of a limit in Corpus Christi as far as opportunity. So I wanted to come back to the Austin area. And then when I went back to school after that, it really opened my mind to a lot. Like, it was next level. Like, everyone that graduates from that program goes to Goldman Sachs and JP Morgan and all the big companies as analysts. But it wasn't for me. I wanted to be, you know, kind of more entrepreneurial and do my own thing. And so that the whole focus was like, I know that I want to be in this business for 30, 40, 50 years. I want to like say that I have the best education and the best skill set that I possibly have. And I looked, honestly, like I looked at it as a competition, and I was thinking to myself, like, and I don't know if this was ego or not. And I've kind of gotten past this, but it was like, all right, I'm trying to do everything I possibly can to where nobody at my age is doing that. Like, that was my mindset. Like, nobody's got their master's in real estate and has done all these deals and by the age of 22, you know, whatever it was. And it was just me just being a competitor and a grinder and a hustler. And I just always wanted to be like, I'm doing more than anyone else. That was always my mindset. And I guess I still somewhat feel like that, but it's not really to me about like doing more than anyone else at this point. It's just doing what I can for me and how I want to set up my life.
Yeah, that's awesome. And I think the grind, you know, especially at a young age, it will set you up for your future. I mean, that's what when I talk to people who are older than me, they're like, yeah, my 20s, you know, I had energy to do all this stuff. So that's awesome. Now, you said that you, you know, we're doing real estate, and then you got into property management, and then you got 250 doors. So can you talk about how you went from zero doors to 250, like relatively quickly?
Yeah, absolutely. So back to the grind, it's hardcore grind. I would, any way and every way I could drum up leads, I was doing it. So, and I never missed a call. I still don't. I mean, if I miss a call, I'm calling them back in an hour. I don't miss stuff. Just super committed. But I would go on the MLS and I would find all the multifamily properties, and I would email the realtors and say, hey, my name's Matt. We're a property management company. Here's our rates. I'd love to buy you lunch. I'd love to buy you coffee. Can I get on your list? Just trying to figure out how to get in front of realtors that were leading to referrals for doors. We would cold call absentee owners. I would cold call for sale by owners. We would send mailers to absentee owners that we knew the properties were rentals. And then we would go hardcore on the social media marketing side. So it's just like every way and any way I possibly could to get in front of people. You know, realtors are a huge source, but then you have owners coming direct. You run into some owners that maybe have 10, 15, 20 properties. Those are huge. You know, I'd get super excited when someone had a big portfolio. And we were taking a lot of risks. You know, we were bootstrapping it in a lot of ways, where we would have, you know, we got to a point where we had $25,000, $30,000 in revenue, but our profit would be all over the place. Like, one month we'd be 10,000 profit. Next month we'd be -4. Next month we'd be +2. And it was just like, but we were growing like 160, 170% per year. And it wasn't really a super sustainable thing. Like my wife was running the company, I was growing it. And we explored like 7 or 8 partnerships. And the one that we recently did took 6 months to make happen. That's why I was telling Adam is like, congrats. I know there's a lot to that. But we found, and this is one of my theories, is like get the people that are really good at what they do and team up with them and grow together. That's that partnership mentality of like me, what I think I'm good at is business development, you know, networking, drumming up new ideas, finding the right people, which is huge in my opinion. And then my wife was a really good operator, but neither of us were like really great at running the business as far as operating, like, you know, what's our profit percentage and all this stuff. And so we found a partner that's literally his biggest strength. And so it was really cool because we merged right before COVID, and now we're at like 35,000, 37,000 a month in profit, and every month that's going up. And so our 30% of that is about 10 or 15,000, which is better than we were ever doing. So we're just super pumped because his name's Manu, and he's running the number. Like for an example, you know, he's like, you guys are paying, you know, 16 cents over at this post office. Well, we're paying 3 at mine. So we switched to post office, and it's like all those little things. He doesn't miss a beat. And that's, I guess all these things that I've done, and there's a lot of real estate jobs that I've had that we can dive into if you want, but it's a culmination of me just subconsciously learning and seeing what's valuable and how other people do it and then putting it in place. So like I did that partnership with the management company, and it's like, oh man, this is really cool. Like this is working. I should probably go do this with other aspects of the business and find people that are really good at certain things and then plug in where they are and where I am, and we all grow together.
I'm really impressed with your blend of business savvy and marketing savvy. That's something you don't see that often. I'm just curious. So having done all these forms of marketing, it sounds like you've done a lot of them. If you were starting out today, if you're talking to our audience members who are just getting started, what things would you be doing right from day one? I mean, as far as, you know, channels you'd be on, social search, just directly reaching out to people. If you had to get started today, what would you be focusing on?
Yeah. And just real quick on that, back to the finding the right people, Andrew is doing all of our marketing, and he's the right guy for that job. In my opinion, he's really good at it. So he's the one putting up the content. For me, I'm super active on Facebook. I mean, like on my phone, I've got, you know, 6-7 hours a day on Facebook, and it's not like I'm staring at it that whole time, but that's what it will say if I got to look at it. And it's turned into, it's a feed of only real estate. Like everything on there is real estate. And I have committed to meeting every person, anybody who's doing anything in Austin, Texas. I'm trying to go meet them. And you know, it could be a high school student. It could be the biggest developer downtown Austin. I'm just super persistent. And I just see people post, I reach out, I buy them coffee, I buy them lunch. And then add real value for these people, like actually say, like, and I've had people, I'm like, how can I add value? They're like, send me deals. So I'm like, no, give me something else. Like, how can I add real value? Everyone can send you deals. Like what you need, you need help with the virtual assistant. You need an employee, you need a freaking light bulb change, whatever it is. Like, I want to go help somebody, and doing that over a long period of time. So I think it's getting yourself out there, meeting the people, adding value for them. Don't have one meeting and never talk to somebody again. You're wasting your time. I've done that. And I forgot, like, oh, I wish I would have stayed in touch with this guy. I can picture his face in my mind. But you know, it was a wasted hour. I mean, maybe subconsciously some stuff stuck, but you know, we're not doing anything actively. So I just get out there. I've got all kinds of stories, man. I got kicked off Bigger Pockets multiple times. Because I was, you know, I'll jump into it, but
yeah, I want to hear these stories. Yeah.
Yeah. So like, I mean, I'm just super aggressive. And like anybody that was posting, I was saying, can I grab coffee? Can we meet? And Bigger Pockets is like, hey, you're sending too many messages. I'm like, okay, I'm sorry. And then I did it again. Like, you're, I'm like, well, how many is too much? Like, you can send three, but you can't send 10. And eventually they just kicked me off and is like, all right. And that sucks. Like, I hate being off that page. I love BiggerPockets. I would go on there every day and I would answer like 25 to 30 unanswered posts. And I would just give them all the value I had on any page. And then my ranking was 10.0 in Austin, Texas. And so people, you know, looked at me as a resource. But, and I'm not kidding, I literally, the only thing I did wrong was reached out to too many people. And I guess I wasn't really listening. I was trying to, I wasn't trying to go over any limit. And I was a paid member too. And I told people all the time, go to BiggerPockets. I'm still a huge fan. But it, you know, it's just like me always pushing everything to the limit, doing as much as I possibly can, 100% always acting with integrity and thinking long term, but just doing more than most people will do. And so just getting out there, man, like meet people. And I tell people on my team, and this is in Austin, I can't say this for every other market, but it's like, if you're not making money in real estate in Austin, Texas, I really believe that you're not trying. I really believe that. And I have people come to me every day and they're like, you got stuff for me to do? I've got plenty of stuff. I've got lists for people to cold call. I've got agents for people to cold call. I've got deals to track down, you know, leads to bring in. Like, there's always something. And what I tell them is you just have to put in the work and think long term, but go, whatever you're trying to do, go hear the word no 100 times. And I promise you, you'll find success. Just collect no's. Go hear people tell you no. And it's like, you just got to get out there. Nothing's given to you. Even to at this point in my career, I have to go and hustle every day. And I think what I've learned is that people hear about real estate and they see the big numbers and they don't realize what it takes. And for me, the real estate's just a byproduct. Like, we'll go buy a property and I really never think about it again. I don't want to go drive by it and look at it and, you know, be fascinated with it, all, any of that. It's like, on to the next. Keep plugging away. Keep calling. Keep hearing the word no. And it's a relentless, and it's, you know, I didn't like cold calling, but after I did it 500 times, I'm like, all right, it's kind of fun. I made it a game. And so these are, some of these things are just cliche, but you got to just love the process. And it's not easy. It's not for everybody, but there's so much potential and so much opportunity. I keep calling it Opportunity City, Austin, Texas. I imagine it's like this in most areas. Like, if you're just getting out there and drumming things up, you're going to make money. But nobody, you know, a lot of people don't want to do it. They want to talk about it. It's like, go knock on 100 doors and I almost guarantee you'll get some kind of lead. You won't get it today, but you'll get, eventually there's a way to make money on it. And I know people that have moved to Austin from other states. All they do is knock on doors and hold open houses and they're killing it. So it's just like, I see all this potential. I have all these visions and ideas and I can only do so much. Like, I could go do all this stuff myself, but it wouldn't allow me to go build the business and like have a big business, in my opinion. And so I'm kind of doing it backwards. Like, I hustled. Now I'm like stepping back and building the team and trying to guide people. And just like I have a guy 2 days ago reached out. He joined our Google call. And then I'm like, yeah, you want to do some stuff? Come over. And he's been cold calling at my house for the last 2 days straight. He's the first person I've seen that like I gave a list to, and he just started doing it right there. And every call he has, I hear him on speaker and I'll give him advice like, hey, say this, ask this, do this. And he's just constantly getting better. He's got 3 leads, like real leads. And he's been cold calling for 2 days. That's it. And so it's just fascinating, man. The opportunity, if you want to put yourself out there and go get it. I mean, there's just so much. And it's, if you have this abundant mindset like we do, we're just helping people out and guiding them and then hoping it comes full circle.
Yeah, you know what's awesome about this episode? I've been having not like a ton of people reaching out to me, but I have friends, you know, they're reaching out asking questions about real estate. And the advice you're giving here is so great because it is a grind. Like, if you want to be successful in real estate, it's easy, but it's a lot of work. Like, it's easy work, but you got to just do it. And there's too many people who are like, well, I want someone else to do it for me. Or, you know, I'm trying to figure out the system, which I fall into that myself sometimes, but it is a grind. And, you know, we found in our business success where, you know, we do the hard things when it comes to marketing to find off-market properties. And that's how we found success. We were doing things that other people weren't, you know, calling 10 times. So it's really cool that you're, you know, this advice you're giving is all around just like, just go do it, you know? So if you're younger listening to this, it's not hard to get to where Matt is, but it's a lot of work, a grinding of doing the right things. So I think that's really cool. And I'm also going to try to reach out to Brandon Turner. You know, he and I have DM'd once on Instagram, so maybe he'll respond. and I'll see if I can get you back on Bigger Pockets from this. So,
I love it, man. But yeah, it's true. Or go ahead.
I was going to say, he DM'd me one time, which I was like freaking out because Brandon Turner DM'd me. But, you know, I'll see if I can get you on Bigger Pockets again.
Come on, baby. I'd love it, yeah, man. I really, because, you know, that was big for me when I was first starting out. If I wanted to type in a question on the internet, like, you know, what is what do you do when this happens? Like, I think Bigger Pockets was new, but it was the only resource for like all these random questions I had. And I loved it, man. I still love it. I think it's a great concept. And yeah, I'd love to be back. But to talk about what you said, I agree with you, but I guess you're right. Like, it's not hard. Like, the roadmap is there, but you just have to go do it. And it can be hard. Like, I mean, I would have, you know, I was started as an agent, so I'd get a call and I have to take it. I can't miss it. And it's like, well, I just sat down to watch a movie with my wife. I got to go take that call. I'm sorry. And it's just a commitment. Like, I really believe this, that I'm as committed to what I do as Kobe Bryant was committed to being an NBA basketball player. Like, it's nice.
Yeah, it's awesome.
I actually believe that. And so to me is like that there's a lot of hard work that goes into that and a lot of commitment and a grind. And the only way that I know that I got to where I'm at is by having that mindset. I think if I did like 75% less or 25% less or 20% less, I wouldn't even be close to where I'm at. And so it's like the compound effect of like going all in and that extra 20% effort now becoming worth 40%, worth 80%, worth 100% more every single day is what gets you there, in my opinion.
So I did want to ask this too, because there's a lot of people who listen to this that are asked questions about, you know, how do I find deals? What are some marketing strategies? So how are you finding deals right now?
Well, I mean, I could go through every way possible. I'll just tell you how I know about finding deals, and then I'll tell you how I find them. But
yeah, that sounds great.
I mean, let's just start on the wholesale side. So you can get any kind of list you want. Utility shutoff list, pre-foreclosure list, divorce list, HOA late fees. You know, you can get all these lists. You can stack the list and find out who's on multiple lists, or you can just go after one list. You can drive around and find for sale by owner signs. You could go knock on doors. You could literally just cold call an entire street. So it's as simple as, there's no secret as to, you know, then you've got some of the stuff that you guys do, like the PPC and the SEO. There's no secret to it. Like, there's no channel that no one's thought of, at least as far as I know, to find a deal. You network, you talk to every person you know, you pass out cards, you talk to people on Facebook, you join all the Facebook groups, and you just attack it from every single angle possible, as much as you can and as consistent as you can. If you have the ability to set up systems where you have VAs or other people doing it and you're tacking everything, then you're not going to miss them. And sometimes you get lucky, right? Because other people are sending mailers too. And maybe they just somehow picked your mailer because it looked a little different. But it's the lists. We make low offers on multiple listing service on the MLS. We make offers on withdrawn properties, on expired properties through the MLS. you know, it's a people business, and that every person you talk to knows somebody that wants to sell or buy real estate. They do. They might not know them right now, but they know them, and you just have to get in front of it and ask all the questions. So that's how I see it. I get my deals through, I make probably about 12 offers a day on MLS, low offers. I get deals that way. I have 35 real estate agents, so they bring me deals. I get deals through networking, through telling people what I'm trying to do. You know, every day I drive down a different street. Every day I walk home a different route. Like, I walk my son to school and then I walk back home. And literally 4 days ago, I was walking on the way home and there's a for sale by owner sign in the street. And I called that guy. We're meeting at his house 35 minutes later. I have a signed contract and I'm going to be buying that property for office space for our company. And
wow, that's awesome.
So, yeah. And that's luck right there. I mean, someone else could have seen it, but you're just in the game. Like, try to be in the game as much as you possibly can. Try to understand values. If you don't understand values, you're definitely going to be clueless. You gotta like look at properties, what they're selling for, what are they appraised at on the county, what are the comps show, what do other people say about it, and then you can make quick decisions and you'll start to get like general ballpark rules, like, hey, anything under Austin and 200,000 is a freaking steal. That's a rule. Now it's up to 300,000, so it's always changing for every market. But try to just like really be plugged in. And I'm a big advocate of getting your real estate license if this is something you want to commit to 100%, because it just gets you in the game a little bit more. Every time I show a property, I'm also considering it for me to buy it, to wholesale it, if my client doesn't want it. Every person that – I got a cold call 2 days ago from a guy from California selling something random. I don't know. And I'm like, hey, man, I appreciate it. But I'm not interested right now. I'm just solely growing our business. You know anyone investing or wanting to buy in Austin, Texas? He's like, yeah, man, I talk to people all the time. I'll store your number. So now I'm texting this guy. A guy came to my house yesterday door knocking, selling pest control services. I'm like, dude, I respect the hustle, man. We're cold calling back here. Tell people if they're looking to sell, we're here, and I'll give you a commission on that. So it's excuse me. It's a lot of lines in the water, like thousands of lines in the water over a very long period of time. And then things start working. And you got to have this mindset. Like, people, wholesalers call me, and I'm on both sides of this, because people call me on my properties and I call other people. And I'll call people and they're like, and I've literally heard some of my agents, and I've had all kinds of stories, but a guy's like, don't ever call me back again. I'm going to cut your head off. And I'm like, golly. How can someone's mind be in that spot? And that, but regardless of that, let's move on. This guy that said that is missing the big picture of how I view it. When someone calls me, I'm not mad. I'm like, hey, I respect the hustle. You know, I'm not really interested in selling. I'd like to see an offer if you want to, but I'd love to get on your list as a buyer. I'd love to buy you coffee or lunch and see if there's other ways that I can help you out. And it's a different mindset that a lot of people don't have, I think. And I'm just doing that on every call. Every call is a potential lead. Every house is a lead. And I'm lucky because we have all these different aspects. It's like, I can add value. There is a way I can add value for somebody. I just have to figure that out and then do that over a long time with a lot of people. And like I said, hopefully things come back full circle on that.
Yeah, that's awesome. And I love the analogy of having 1,000 lines in the water. I mean, that takes time to be able to get all of those out there. But once you set them up, I mean, the chances of you catching something are a lot higher. So that's really cool that you, you know, have done that over the past 10 years. So how can people get in touch with you? You know, if someone's listening to this, you know, they're motivated by your story or they want to buy in Austin, what are some ways people can reach out?
Yeah, I'm super easy, man. I'm happy to give my cell phone number, 512-914-4806. 512-914-4806. My email is just matttyfke@gmail.com. You can look us up, TRE, here in Austin. We're on every social media platform. I'm very easy to get a hold of.
Yeah, that's awesome. I don't know many people who put their cell phone out. So that's awesome that, you know, I think people will reach out. I'm sure they'll have questions.
Speak on that, man, like I want to harp on this. Like, you just got to be an operator. Like, I'm serious. Like, if someone calls me from this podcast, I'm going to figure out a way to help them. And that's another one of my things is like, don't talk about it, be about it. Like, I'm really being about this and I'm putting my money where my mouth is. And, you know, I challenge people to test me out. But the point of that is that's what it takes. I believe that. I think that's what it takes to accomplish a lot and to do a lot. And I think very big and I make a ton of sacrifices. Like, you know, I've got my partner and I own over 40 properties here in Austin and I drive a Prius and people make fun of that. And I could drive any car I want. And it's not about like, it's just a mindset that I have. Like, I'd rather be investing and I'm not a luxury. I don't have huge luxury plans, but I want to do big things and I want to help people. And I see that it takes sacrifice and it's like, it's the same Gary Vee stuff, but it's like if you're complaining about it, the question is what are you doing? Like, are you watching Netflix? Do you have a favorite show, but yet you're complaining about real estate? Well, you're just making excuses. If you're not making excuses and you're happy where you're at, it's great. But I'm just like, I want to help the people that want to do this and that are serious about it. I want to help them get there because I've been in that spot. And I've been there where nobody helped me and I've been there where people did help me. And I just, you know, want to pay it back in some ways. There's also value that I'll get from that long term, maybe. So I just really want to help those people and the people that are wanting to do it, but not doing anything. That's super frustrating because they're just wasting my time, their time, everyone's time. And they think they want it, but they don't.
Yeah, no, that's awesome. I think that's so cool that you're helping people out and having that mindset, you know, be about it is awesome. And then you also have a podcast, right? Other people can listen to your podcast.
Yeah, man. We used to have one called Young Wild Financially Free. We've got like 70, 80 episodes. We just started a new one called The Real Estate Podcast. And somehow we got that name and no one else did. So it's like people overlooked it, I guess. But it's
super jealous of that.
Yeah. The Real Estate Podcast. We've got 4 episodes. We released one today about the benefits of Tesla moving, a facility, the new Cybertruck facility to Austin. And we're just constantly putting stuff out there, man.
Yeah, that's awesome. So I'll link to that in the show as well. And then I'll link to your website for people to get in touch with you. I'll also, you know, put your cell phone number out there for people to reach out. And I think this was such a great episode, especially for people who are, you know, newer to this. They want to get into real estate. Like, just hearing your story and how you got to where you are, you know, still 29, right?
Yep.
Yep. So still in your 20s and like, you know, you're part owner in a management company that has 750 doors. Like, that's really cool and motivating for our listeners. So thanks so much for coming on to our episode. And, you know, I think we'll probably have other stuff we're doing too. We always got stuff in the works of, you know, trying to, you know, meet with other people and, you know, potentially get some other people, you know, on our podcast. So I'm sure there'll be more things we're doing in the future.
Awesome. Absolutely, man. I'm excited about it as well.
Well, thanks so much. And, you know, like I said, we'll get all that stuff in the show notes for the people. And, you know, hey, if you like this episode, please subscribe, give us a 5-star review, write a comment. And yeah, we'll talk to you guys later.
All right. Thanks, everyone. Appreciate it.
Thank you for listening to the Real Estate Marketing Podcast. Please like and subscribe for more content like this. We'll see you later.